Joe, let me come back to you. Everything you say is important, and I've always paid attention to every time you talk, and you said something recently that I thought this would be a good opportunity to ask you about it.
Make sure you tell my wife
that. All right. She gave me that line. You recently told the Tribune that many voters generally think that aldermen are clowns, incompetent, and corrupt. Why? And do you think the current crop of aldermen can change that perception? I mean, you do have Ed Burke. He's still on the city council 5 years after his office was raided. Talk about that.
Well, first of all, it's a long time American pastime to criticize and make fun of the people who represent you. You know, that's a part of democracy. But I also think that, unfortunately, a number of our colleagues who went past the straight and narrow and strayed from doing the right thing and tried to use the office to enrich themselves and in the process violated the law, they've brought disrepute among all of us. And it's unfortunate. I can say in the 28 years that I served on the city council that the vast majority, and I say this very sincerely, that the vast majority of aldermen I had the privilege of serving with were hardworking, they cared about their communities, and they always tried to do the right thing. So when I stated to the Tribune about that impression, I wasn't stating at all that that was the truth. Instead, that's the unfortunate impression that that many voters have of the city council.
And that's why I was terrified. Yeah, careful to say that's what you were thinking, that voters sometimes think, not
right.
You. Pat, you longevity on city council is your thing. So turnout in the February 2019 municipal elections hit just over 35%. The April runoff saw even less in terms of turnout. What do you do to spark voters' interest in people who hold these offices that so closely affect their lives? I mean, you know, people are voting for president, whatever, but you're the folks who are in our community. How do you spark the interest?
Well, I think you talk about President Trump. No, I'm teasing.
Okay.
I mean, you know, but I mean, think about it. What have people been doing lately to get people to come out and vote? If you're running for a statewide office, even if it has nothing to do with choice, people are talking about the right to choice, Roe v. Wade, because they're trying to find a topic that they can in some way make their office seem like it has some nexus to something that it has nothing to do with. They're trying to find things that will touch a nerve to get people to come out and vote, because politics, in my opinion, at all levels, is really turning people off. The more we have the ability to communicate like we do, I mean, anybody with a phone or a computer can communicate something to the world. So the more that we communicate in that way, the less we're actually communicating. And so people are turned off by politics. They're turned off by the negativity, which is pretty much all you see now, because negative is what most consultants will tell you is you have to go to. And so how do you get people to come out and vote? I think we need to do some things to the election code in this country to work on making it more, I won't say more civil, I don't think you can in a free society, but to making it more important to come out and vote. I mean, in Australia, if you don't vote, you pay a fine, okay? In other places where you see the closest, as Joe said, the closest part of government to the person is gonna have the lowest turnout lately. I mean, think about it, 30% of the people that were eligible to vote, and that's only the people who are registered, the people who are eligible to vote is much higher. We're electing people to office and we're calling it landslides and they're getting 20%. It's a sad, sad statement in a country where we say we treasure freedom and we treasure the right to vote, and yet we're exercising it less and less. And in part, it's the quality of the people that are running and the tenor of the campaigns that are being run, in my opinion. I don't have an answer to make more people turn out, but maybe changes to the election code could make it more important to show up.
I think Marge has the answer for how to get people to turn out.
Of course I have the answer. What a question, Paul. No, I just wanted to say that I think that, you know, the current crop of aldermen and those that are running for aldermen in this next election, you know, simply need to be out there talking to the people. And the fact that we have a rather small geographic area allows us to actually get out there and meet people, whether it means knocking on doors or going to the PTA meeting or going to the Chamber of Commerce meeting or local school councils or whenever there's a gathering. I think that one can, whether they be an elected official or running for office, have the opportunity when you're running once again in a ward to actually get out there and meet the people yourself. And I'm not trying to dissuade anybody from using, you know, social media or any other method of communicating, but communication is the key. And I think that's really how you talk people into participating in our democracy.
I want to ask something I'd love to get each of you to chime in on. I may twist it as we go, but Mayor Lightfoot has pushed back on this notion that she has all these contentious relationships on city council. I think she said the other day, I'm 60, I'm not going to change, which means we're all in trouble, by the way. I'm not going to change. It's the way I am. I'm pushing people to get rid of the status quo. From the standpoint of tone, Tom, let me start with you. What has Mayor Lightfoot gotten right and wrong in her handling of relationships, from your view?
You want me to answer that question?
Sure. And they're all listening. They're all coming after you.
Where's the exit? I just want to know where the exit. Okay. Nice. Be nice. You know, my mother and father were good proponents of that, to be nice to everybody. I did a lot of jury trials. I was a public defender. I did, dozens and dozens of murder cases and death penalties. And when you talk to a jury, you have to be nice. And that's all I got to suggest. Nice. I mean, well, it's so simple it defies logic. But
so, Marge, nice. let me come to you. Okay. Same question. Okay. However, I want to add something to it because as I'm hearing about being nice, look, you all worked with Rahm Emanuel, and I don't know about you. Maybe we've all had the chance to have us called names by Rahm Emanuel. He had certainly had some for me. My point is, he had a couple, but I can't say it on the mic. He had a colorful way of speaking for sure, but he got what he wanted. So I guess I'm sort of wondering, is it possible to lead with maybe a rougher style of politics, or is it, as Tom said, about being nice?
No, I'm still in the nice category, and my father used to have a sign outside his office said that it was nice to be important, but it wasn't more important to be nice. But I'll say, in the case of Lori Lightfoot, I do have to give her credit for getting through COVID. I mean, that is just such an incredible situation for every elected official across the country, just to survive what we've been through for the last 2.5 years. I'm going to have to give her credit for that, absolutely.
And Joe, again, you worked with Emanuel, just for your point of view in all of this, how much does mayoral style matter to accomplishing things? Does she need to be nice?
It matters a lot. Being mayor of Chicago is a tough, tough, tough job. And the last 3 years, it's tough times 70. It's just an incredibly tough job. And I think if you look past in recent history, the mayors we've had, certainly in my lifetime, I don't know if nice is the word I would use to describe them, but what I would use to describe them is effective. They understood the art of politics. Many of them, most of them, had been in politics for many years, and they understood the need to build relationships with members of the city council, to work with them, listen to them, find out what their needs are, find out what they need for their community, and do their best to try to meet those needs. The two mayors I worked with, Mayor Daley, who many of you know, we had our disagreements over the years, but when it came to my ward, He was always there. I never felt like we were being punished or my constituents were being punished because I had my differences with the mayor. And so we had a very respectful relationship. We worked together on issues pertaining to ward, quite frankly, on most issues pertaining to the city. My relationship with Rahm Emanuel was a little bit different. I felt myself ideologically in agreement with most of what he did, not everything, but most. And what he was able to do, an art that he perfected when he was one of the leaders in the House of Representatives, was to really listen, to reach out, to call you, to talk with you, to find out what you were thinking, what you needed. And that made him, despite the fact that he was pretty unpopular by the time he left office among the general public, among the members of the city council, he, for the most part, the vast majority of them respected him, they supported him, and I would suspect that 80% of them voted for him because they realized that he understood what we needed as aldermen, and because of that that mutual respect, he was a very effective mayor, I believe.
And Pat, I'm wondering, because you can go back to Harold Washington, and so, I mean, I think he was really beloved by people. People loved Harold. So I'm sort of curious, how much did it play into your work or your relationships, knowing whether you had a mayor who was maybe not as popular among people, and then one who was just beloved?
Well, not to critique them all, but I will say this. Harold was a tremendous individual when you met with him. He had a great sense of humor. Came during the height of council wars, he came out to a picnic in our ward. He and I went to a festival at a Greek church in our ward. People that probably wouldn't vote for him were lining up to take a picture with him and to enjoy a couple minutes with him. He had an aura that helped him break down people when he met them individually. I will say each mayor has their own personality, but most mayors encourage people to get along. And even when someone disagrees with you, while they might personally be upset, they generally don't castigate you in the public. And they generally don't come down upon you in public because they're wise enough to know that they're going to need your vote again for the next hard issue. And at some point, you're going to poison the water so much that people are just going to be against you because. And so I just think that wise elected officials realize that today's voting majority doesn't stay together unless you work hard to maintain it, and you're always looking to add rather than lose, because you will naturally lose some people over the merits of various issues. And I think that that's what needs to be done now.
Marge, let me ask you, the current city council has political positions ranging from conservative to socialist and progressive. Given the tone of city council now as you see it, what sense do you have of what the 2023 city council will look like? And I'll ask all of you this sense. What do you think the number one issue that a new city council is going to face will be?
I suspect, given the situation today, that the crime issue and public safety issue here in the city is probably one that's on the top of the list as far as issues that the new city council will face and the candidates going forward. And I don't see any way around that. Obviously, there's other issues, whether it be, issues that face the country in general. Gas prices, grocery prices, but I think that crime is going to be one that people are especially concerned with.
Is there anybody who thinks crime is not the number one issue in 2023? I'm going to kind of guess you all might feel that way for the city. You do.
But that's as long as you understand that crime is just not the act of the crime and the statistics. It's all of the things that go into fighting the crime. When you are looking at crime in a city, you're looking at the need for good police, you're looking at the need for good prosecution, you're looking at the need for good health care, good mental health care.
Exactly.
All of those things. are part of the crime issue. So if you just say stopping crime, you're leaving out all of the things that you need to build in the infrastructure for to really put up what you need to do to make crime less likely to happen for a long period. Suppression works for a while, but somewhere along the line, you got to invest in all the other things.
So here's maybe an uncomfortable question for you. So I'm not going to be my former law professor self and call on anybody in particular, but I'll just invite you to chime in. Because as you talk about these issues, and you look at the current crop of mayoral candidates that are, as it is, and it's going to change and there will be more, I'm sure. Do you expect Chicago will make a change at the top? And is there anybody that you're seeing, either by name or by type, that you'd say, here's what Chicago needs going forward as a mayor?
I'll define this generically. While this has been unfolding in the last year or so, and I always thought to myself, well, the ideal candidate for Chicago, being in Chicago my whole life, like most of us here are, has to be someone who is middle of the road. I don't want to use the word moderate, but I guess that's what political people would call it. Moderate, who has some government, elected or otherwise, experience, who can work with people, who is respectful of the rainbow of aldermen, people that are in the city, and someone that has been tested a little bit. Because to walk into the office of mayor of the city of Chicago with zero political experience is a tough task. I'm sure my colleagues here would agree. So I think those are the traits, and they have to be able to compromise. They have to be, okay, mom, nice. My mom says, be nice. You just be nice. You're six brothers, and don't beat them over the head. That's what we were taught to do. We didn't always follow that rule, but I think generally that's what you want. I don't think it's a job for a political novice. I really don't think so. I think because the learning curve is too steep.
So are you saying you expect there might be a change at the top?
At the voter, at the ballot box,
It will be in a new mayoral election.
Well, as I look at the landscape here, and first of all, politics, 30 days is an eternity in politics, okay? People look out now, and then you see in February, because the crime statistics are going to come down, the commercials are going to come flying in, and everything's going to be rosy, But right now, I think, the way I look at this landscape, I'm not privy to the polling numbers, but, people on the street are not happy. They're not happy. They're not happy with the crime. They're not happy with the tone. They're not happy with, the fighting and the scuffling. And, I would say, it doesn't look too promising for an incumbent right here.
Joe, you're everywhere. You're always in restaurants. You're around. You talk to people. What is your sense of what we might see at the top? And anybody you want to mention or stylistically talk about as a possible new mayor?
Anyone who can tell you today that they know who's going to be elected mayor in April, because there will be a runoff, is completely on drugs. There is no way of knowing. But I agree with Tom that having experience in politics, holding previous elected office, is very, very helpful, because there are things you learn about how to be an effective leader that you can't just read in a book. You have to experience them.
Is that about having been an alderman? Is that about having been maybe a former governor? Is that about having been a congressman?
Yeah. Yes, exactly. I'm glad I made myself clear, Paul. Thank you. I think the only person I can think of in local Illinois politics is Jim Thompson. He had never held office, but he was a very effective governor, whether you agreed with him or not. He seemed to instinctively understand how to do the job, but I think he is the exception that proves the rule. that by and large, if you look historically, you don't, all you have to do is look at the most recent president we had. Someone who comes in without any leavening experience that being in politics and being in government provides is going to have a tougher job.
So Marge, you were a teacher in a former life, but you also took the seat that your dad had held.
That's correct.
Yeah, did that count as like the experience Joe was talking about? I mean, just through osmosis through your dad?
Oh, absolutely. I was so grateful to be able to have had him give me advice on working within the community and in the city council. I mean, I just don't know how these young people enter into politics today without having some sort of a mentor. And, you know, I certainly, when I speak to them, I always recommend that they do find themselves mentor, and I did that during my intern program at the city council, but it was especially helpful. But I just wanted to go back once again. I have no predictions on, you know, what the outcome of the next election is going to be, but sometimes I look at the city council kind of like a big corporation, and the mayor is the CEO. And here's what I wanted to say. The Chicago City Council is kind of like the board of directors, all right? And it's important that you spend your time and effort not only looking at the mayor's race, which is very exciting, but let me assure you that the members of the city council that are going to be elected have much to say about what direction the city goes in. So once again, mayor's races are very exciting, but also take a look at what's happening in your local community and make sure that you have qualified candidates running and that you indeed are supporting them.
Pat, do you also think it requires experience? I mean, Lightfoot didn't have government experience when she came in. She was a partner in a law firm. How important is it to you?
I think it's helpful. And the only way that you can make up for that experience is finding people to surround yourself with who have experience and who know what the new know government or, and know the political landscape, and then take their advice as opposed to bring them around you and ask them to voice what you want to hear. Because when Joe mentions Jim Thompson came in and he was a former U.S. attorney. But if you looked at people he brought in, they were all seasoned government people. Mm-hmm. And he had a cabinet that basically gave him good advice, and the important thing is he took it. So sometimes you don't have to be the most experienced, you just have to be a good listener, and you have to be someone who knows to take good advice. And experience, I think, is helpful, because every once in a while you're gonna have to make a call when your advisors can't come to an agreement.
So I'm going to ask each of you this question, and then I'm going to come to the audience for questions that you might have. So that's a bit of a warning that we're getting ready for you. But let me also kind of get this sense from you. I keep asking about the mayor because that's the newspaper every day, right? That's the front page. But you know what? I already said there's 14 aldermanic positions that, you know, 50 are open technically, right? Mm-hmm. So, Tom, let me ask you, for the multitudes of Chicagoans who might be thinking about running for alderman, what advice do you have for this? Is a 24/7 job. James Kappelman said on my show he got called once to go get a tarantula out of somebody's backyard. What advice besides not running do you have for people who are considering running for alderman, Tom?
Thick skin. You have to have thick skin, okay? And you have to be able to take a hit and not get your blood boiling and retaliate. Own you, they pay your salary. I mean, this is what, you know, you hear over the course of being, you know, in public office, and they're right, okay? So you just have to be someone that is not thin-skinned. You have to take a beating and keep on ticking. I mean, that's the best advice I have. And you have to know going in that you're gonna take criticism, ridiculous criticism, and you know, you cheat, you lie, you steal, you're all that stuff that goes with it. You're crooks, like Joe had said. The public perception is out there. It's kind of like, however, when they need you and you know, they hate you until they need you, okay? Just like kind of a lawyer. Everybody hates lawyers until they need a lawyer, you know? But, so I think that's the best advice I would give. And while we're on the subject about voters and how do you get the numbers up, I'm really disappointed my colleagues is here didn't come up with our age-old way that we would get the vote out, and that was you give them a new garbage can. Right?
Yeah,
right?
Of course.
I mean, I can't believe nobody. No. I mean, so anyway.
And they're quick. You know, Marge, one of Michelle Smith, who also retired now from city council, and she was saying, I thought she was kidding, but I talked about people calling 311, and she and Kappelman on my show talked about how they gave constituents their cell phone numbers. And here it is, you can reach me. And then I said, you know, call her first. No, call 311. And she went, no, call your alderman first. What is your view on that?
Oh, we always wanted people to call our office first, okay? And truthfully, we suspected that as soon as they hung up the phone speaking to us or sending us an email, then they contacted 311, which was fine, but it was just another opportunity for us to connect with our voters. So that was very important to me. But I wanted to add, in addition to what Tom mentioned, especially the thick skin situation with running for office, another thing, unfortunately, is that aldermanic races have gotten very, very expensive. So you need to be able to spend your time, you know, raising some money to be able to be competitive in these races. And once again, unfortunately, when I first started, it wasn't very expensive, but by the time that I left, it was certainly. And I know it's the cost of running for office and having the proper support, having the proper legal advice, making sure that you're filing all your papers properly is indeed something that's all part of the process.
I might have Joe hand you his business card for consulting on the right. Yeah, Joe.
And I would add, it's very important to surround yourself with good people. You know, a successful governor surrounds him or herself with good people. So does a successful alderman. I was very blessed to have a very community-oriented, hardworking, intelligent chief of staff, Kevin O'Neill, who's joined us today. Thank you, Kevin, for your years of service to the 49th Ward. Appreciate that. I had to get that in, Paul.
Yeah, no, we're giving Kevin the check for our table, so hopefully that's all right. And Pat, your thought about what you would advise people who are thinking of running for alderman.
Well, the first thing is I get a lot of calls from people that are thinking about it in my ward and in some of the wards around, and maybe it's a function of longevity, or maybe they've just hit the bottom of the barrel and I'm the last call. But I will tell you, I often tell them, first and foremost, look at your family situation. Do you have children? Do you have a supportive wife? Are they on board with this? Are your children of an age where criticizing your parents at school is going to be a problem? Are they going to be old enough to read the comments in paper or on social media, and how's that going to affect them? Take your personal life into account before you make this decision, because it will, no matter how well prepared you are, disrupt your personal life. For many people, running for alderman represents a significant pay increase. And so for those folks, they might look at it as, well, if I get this, this is going to really enhance my personal income. And that's the worst reason to include. But quite honestly, it's one of the things that when you look at people coming to the council and you look at what they did before, and then look at what they're doing now, they've doubled or tripled their salary. There's no requirements other than being of voting age and live in a neighborhood to be an alderman. You don't see many partners at accounting firms or law firms or people that are in big businesses running for alderman, because it is a job that presents personal challenges. It's a job that for them probably represents a cut in pay. And it's a job that for them, basically, I think a lot of people in the city today are looking at it and say, it's not worth the bad things that are going to happen to me to run for this office, and I'll take a pass. And you look at that, and that's alderman, and that unfortunately is mayor as well. We've had some very well-qualified, very seasoned individuals that took a long, hard look at this and turned it down and said, no, it's not worth it to me. And so I think the first thing I would say is look at your personal situation and determine if you win. is it going to be worth it to you to have done that? Because it is a significant lifestyle change.
Yeah, if you do your job right 24 hours a day, you make about minimum wage when you're done, right?
Paul, let me, if I could add something and give an illustration of what Pat's talking about. It didn't come to my mind until you started mentioning family, obviously, Pat. I'll give you an example. All right, I got in 93. 2 years later, I was chasing some lady in housing corps with junk houses, and she got real mad. So she hired somebody to kill me, and it's true. So
didn't work.
Yeah, it didn't work. And I don't want to tell you how much what the fee was. Yeah. It was $500 for the head of an alderman. That was it. All right. So it's for real. And I had four young kids at the time, and then you know, police were gonna sit on my house or all that stuff. A big commotion there in school because people get crazy. They get crazy, and we are the, like Joe and everyone says, we're the front line of attack. So yeah, it can happen for real. And she got indicted, and eventually they pled the case out. But and she wanted to kill me with a hatchet, believe it or not. I mean, I have the audio tape because they had to get a body wire. She hired a hitman, and the hitman was an undercover cop. So I got the audio tape, and she said he's got blue eyes and blonde hair, but my hair's not blonde anymore. But it was, and gave him my picture, the whole nine yards. So there is a price. Pat's right. So.